you so much. Mo' Better Blues, that one was written by Mr. Branford Marsalis, and it's a theme to a movie starring Denzel Washington, Mo' Better Blues. Now, we have spoken of great directors, great actors, whatnot. We recently lost one of the greatest film directors, producers of all time, and Mr. Melvin Van Peebles. Yeah, you can clap for him, because he was a bad man. And I go all the way back maybe you do too. You might remember Godfrey Cambridge and the Watermelon Man. Y'all remember that? Yeah, yeah. So what we wanted to do was take a song that was written by Herbie Hancock by the same title, and we're gonna dedicate this to Mr. Melvin Van Peebles. It's entitled Watermelon Man. Y'all can clap your hands if you want. Yeah, you can do that. Thank you. Thank y'all so much. Watermelon Man by Herbie Hancock, dedicated to the late, great Melvin Van Peebles. Y'all know some of this music, huh? Well, you about to know some more of it. You know, it's been my honor to call this man my friend for a long time, to have played gigs with him over the years. A gentleman who, wow, he's played with everybody. Aretha Franklin, Ike and Tina Turner, I don't know. Name somebody, he probably played with them. But this man recorded some of the guitar parts on the iconic Superfly album by Curtis Mayfield. I want you to put your hands together for Superfly Craig McMullen, y'all.
Hello, hello, hello. Oh, we live up in here. Yeah, everybody looking like you can go rob the bank with me tomorrow. Yeah, it's all good though. Anyway, I have the pleasure of being here with this particular band. I'm not going to get into anything personal about them, but technically, none of them have got any divorces, the ones that are married. And the ones that are not married, they have not been picked up on child support. So what you can say is that this is generally a good urban jazz coalition band. And I feel honored to be up here with them tonight. But more so, I'd like to also say that Will Haygood. Now, I am a student at Ohio State, thanks to my mentor. I got to do the shout out, so I got the mics in. Dr. Ted McDaniels is in the house tonight. And through his mentorship and him allowing me to be in the Ohio State Jazz Ensemble, which is supposed to be the bad ASS band at Ohio State, I was under his, as they say, tutelage. You know what I'm talking about. I'm under his direction. Bernice, help me out. Miss McDaniel, that's personal. Y'all don't know about that. Anyway, I want to say one thing that I took one of my classes that I succeeded in at Ohio State was Black literature. So we're in a class and we're being assigned different writers, et cetera, and as they say, lo and behold, I hear that we have assignment and we get to choose between blah, 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 and Will Haygood. And I'm saying to myself, wait a minute, Will Haygood from East High School, et cetera, I'm going to be studying Will Haygood. Or at least that's my choice. So naturally, me being a former East High Tiger, what else would I do besides study Will Haygood? Now, I'm just saying that at Ohio State. At Ohio State, he is there to be studied, not dissected, like physically dissected, but his works are great. So all in all, I'm just honored to be up here tonight. Oh, it's going to be night pretty soon, where the vampires come from, anyway. I'm just honored to be up in here and to be able to play some of this music. And maybe I'll explain a little bit about this music to you. Not a little bit, but all of it. Right. Yes, one thing I say is, I'm the only one that played on every track on Superfly. Even Curtis didn't play on every track. So, out of all those millions that were supposed to go down, and probably a lot of you saw the Jet magazine that was put out 11 months before Superfly. Well, he said he grossed 20 million, and I don't know, I still was playing rent over there in Poindexter, so it did, you know what I'm talking about. Anyway, but I'm just honored there, and as you can see, I'm stalling time, which is what musicians do. Now, the first song we're going to do, and I'll elaborate on it later.
Put your hands together for Craig McMullen, y'all. Now, time is getting late. So Craig, we got time for one. So can we give him some Superfly? Can we do that? Yeah, they said your speech was so long.
I thought the pusher man was gonna come up in here.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and play some Superfly for y'all. Thank y'all so much.
Thank you very much. Anybody want to come up here and play? No, I'm just kidding. We will be getting to the main featured person in this fabulous Columbus Main Library. And soon as Will gets a chance to get up here, which is going to be soon. And then also, don't forget about the book signing and the purchases. And also, there's going to be a Q&A session. That's short for questions, answers, and bill payments. Thank you again. How about one more time for the Urban Jazz Coalition? Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Carnegie Author Series. Please welcome Library Chief Executive Officer Patrick Lisinski.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. How good does it feel to be together, right? I'm taking your picture. I don't want to forget it. Wow, terrific. How about the Urban Jazz Coalition? What, you want to give it up for them? This is not your mother and father's library anymore, is it? They were warming up. I was here about 12:30, and I said, man, we want to book you every month. And they said, bring your checkbook, and we're good. So fellas got to eat. I get it. Well, welcome to the main library and to the Seymour Family Reading Room. This is part of our Carnegie Author Series, and so we are welcoming guests who are here in person, but we also have guests in online, so a special welcome to them. I want to give a thanks and a shout out to Demetrius Neely and Javon Carter. They are our event co-sponsors from the King Arts Complex. Please stand up, Javon, over there. And as always, we appreciate our sponsorship and support from NBC4 and the Friends of the Library. And, they're going to be here after during the book signing and playing, but just one more time, Urban Jazz Coalition. Great, great job, gentlemen. So we're about 3/4 of the way through more than 2 weeks of local appearances by Will Haygood, including the King Lincoln Theater, the Wexner Center for the Arts, Columbus Museum of Art, Drexel Theater, Gateway Film Center, Metropolitan Club, Columbus State Community College, Gramercy Books, and more. And yet, here we are with another large and devoted audience. And so, Will, I think there's no doubt how much Columbus loves you, and I know you love Columbus, so. This type of logistical coordination does not happen without a tremendous amount of planning, and I want to thank Tom Katzenmeyer, the president and CEO at Greater Columbus Arts Council, and his team for their tireless efforts, and one man who likes to stay behind the scenes, but he invests in this community, our institutions, and our young people time and time again. He was absolutely the driving force behind all of Will's appearances. Would you join me in thanking Larry James? Larry, please stand up. We're eager to hear Will discuss his latest book, Colorization, 100 Years of Black Film in a White World. Some of you know this, but this is Will's 9th book, and we have partnered with him for The Butler, Showdown, Tigerland, and now his latest. I want to make sure you all understand just how lucky we are to host Will, really for the kickoff of his new book. His reputation continues to soar with a remarkable trajectory. Do you know how hard it is to get reviewed in the New York Times? Colorization has been reviewed in the New York Times with a photo of Will Haygood and the International New York Times. He was also just reviewed by the National Book Review under the title of 5 Hot New Books. Right? And I know about the National Book Review because Will emailed that to me Saturday morning at 3 a.m. So if you want to know what it takes to be a great author, that's what it is. He does not sleep. One day I asked Will if he could single out one attribute, influence, that made him a successful writer, what would it be? And he said, Pat, it was my visits to the Columbus Metropolitan Library. Now, I have to tell you, he really didn't say that. But if you repeat that story time and time again, we will never correct you. There are going to be plenty of Will's books available for checkout with your library card after the program. Be sure to take a look at the fully stocked displays at the back of the room. If you do not have your library card, today is the perfect time to sign up. It is free. And if you'd like to get a book signed, a selection of Will's books are available for purchase at the conclusion of the remarks when we will continue to listen to our musical guests. Imagine how challenging it is for those of us who work in a library when we have to decide what to read, when we are literally faced with 2 million titles that we could choose from each day. My son gave me a copy of Giannis Antetokounmpo's biography, and when I read the dedication, I immediately thought of Will Haygood, because in the dedication is a quoted Nigerian proverb: however far the stream flows, it never forgets its source. Friends, that proverb describes Will Haygood. He's visiting us today from his home in Washington, D.C. Let's give a rousing welcome home to Columbus. Welcome to Will Haygood.
Thank you very, very much. The other night, and I was at the Drexel Theater, they've kicked off a wonderful film series anchored to this book. Linda Cass, I think Linda might be here, she might not be, but anyway, her bookstore has played a significant role in this film series. And when I was at the theater, somebody asked me to go out on the street to look at the marquee. And I did, and because I came in through the back door. And so I went out on the street and looked at the marquee, and it's the James Bond movie, No Time to Die. But right under that was the title of my book, yeah. Colorization. Will Haygood and James Bond, I'm wondering if I should start introducing myself by saying Haygood. Will Haygood. And I'll take that martini shaken, not stirred. The movie that they played at the Drexel that night was Foxy Brown. Foxy Brown. Now, when I was a teenager, every teenage friend of mine had a big crush on Pam Grier. I mean, I used to fantasize about walking around Franklin Park with Pam Grier. I once wrote a book about Sammy Davis Jr. and the Entertainer. Sammy had a weird, strange habit. He would call a news conference to announce that he wasn't seeing a certain lady, or that he wasn't involved in a relationship with a certain lady. So he would call a news conference and say, "Hey, it's not true that I have anything going on between Marilyn Monroe and myself." Of course, Marilyn Monroe, she would be at home and she would say, "What in the hell is he talking about?" And he would do the same thing, Sammy would, with Lena Horne and Dorothy Dandridge. She would call a news conference and say, "Hey, there's nothing to the rumor that I am seeing Dorothy Dandridge and the beautiful actress." Now, you can look this up. A few years ago, I was on the talk show, Wayne Brady's talk show. There were two guests that day, Will Haygood and Pam Grier. So it dawns on me that this is a nice time to tell you that there has never been anything going on with Will Haygood and Pam Grier. But I'm sitting in the green room with Foxy Brown, munching on some jelly beans, me and Pam Grier. She stands up and she says, "Will, I have a favor to ask you." And I looked into Foxy Brown's big, beautiful eyes and I said, "Pam, you can ask me anything that you want to." And she said, "And I'd like you to sign my book, please." So that's what I did. She was holding my Sammy Davis Jr. book. So don't read too much into it that my face mask has a picture of Foxy Brown on the cover. I want to thank Pat Lozinski. He and I met the very year he got this job. I flew home and I was just home visiting family, and he and I met here and at the library, and I could tell him about, you know, my trips here as a kid. And he sat and he listened, and then it wasn't long thereafter that he invited me to be one of the Celebration of Learning authors. And I just have to think how proud my grandmother and mother, who used to give me money to come to the library on Saturday mornings, I would catch the bus, how proud they would be. Speaking of books, this is a very difficult time in this nation's history. There is no doubt about it. There are people in certain cities trying to take books out of libraries because they don't like the subject matter of books. And I'm talking about books written by the great Toni Morrison, Ralph Ellison, we can go on. And some people are using this attack on books and they're calling it critical race theory. Let me send out a warning. Don't try to take any of Will Haygood's books out of the library, because I got family members up in here and they're going to stop that. When I was a foreign correspondent and I would go into a land that had been blasted by rebels, people with guns, one of the first things they would do, they would burn books. So if there's any assault on libraries and books anywhere, we all have to rise up. We really do. If we can send somebody on the moon, it's to our detriment that we can't settle things on Earth. One of the reasons I was so happy that Larry James, with his genius, and the Greater Columbus Arts Council scheduled this week is because every time I come home and I'm riding around town visiting friends or family, and I see kids at the bus stop, that was me, because there wasn't a car in my family. So that was me, always catching the bus or always walking someplace to learn or to go fishing or else to come to the library and learn or going back and forth to school. Leonard King is a good friend of mine, and he asked me, have the kids been invited? And I told him that I wanted that to happen, and so he got in touch with school board member Jim Raglin, and he made it happen. And so there are some students here from around town, and I'm very happy that they are. And I want to say something to the students about the world that I navigate. It's the arts. The Akron Beacon Journal, the Kansas City Star, the Miami Herald, the Los Angeles Times, the St. Petersburg Times, and the Cleveland Plain Dealer. And I could add about 15 more newspapers that turned me down, that when I applied for them, I didn't get the job. So let it inspire you, students, when somebody doesn't think that you're quite ready for their newspaper or to film their script. All of these arts category, writing, filmmaking, book publishing, they're all a challenge, and they're a big challenge. But I'm here to tell you, if little Will Haygood, who used to walk around town, can make it, then so can you. My last book before this one, and it was Tigerland, about the fabled East High School year of 1968-1969. One of the coaches from that team is here, Mr. Paul Pinnell, who has become, since that book, a very dear friend. And can you stand up, coach? And I think that the star and the golden boy of that year and that team is here. I think he might be here. Ed Ratliff. Is Ed Ratliff in the house? There he is. He flew all the way from the West Coast to be here today. And I can't tell you, wherever I go with Tigerland, people come up to ask me and say, what is it like to know the great Eddie Ratliff? He is truly a national treasure in my book, and after all, I wrote the book. People have been asking me if I was going to have a chance to read from this book, and I haven't had a chance really to read since I've been here, because these have been in events and moments where I've been sitting down with people on a stage talking to the audience. So here's a moment where I have a chance to read from the book. And first little section I'm going to read is about the great filmmaker Oscar Michaud. Many scholars have written about him, but his life is not known well enough. One of those scholars is here. Ron Green. Green is here. Thank you for coming out. Where's Ron at? Ron. Thank you, good man. So this first section is about the great filmmaker Oscar Micheaux, and he has written a novel called The Homesteader that he wants to turn into a movie. And so he has started filming the movie in this little section. These appearances on his roving movie set suggest Oscar Micheaux was enjoying himself immensely. Not long after filming ended, it was announced that The Homesteader would premiere in February 1919. Oscar Micheaux, who had once sold his books door to door, had a movie he now had to market. He relished writing his own advertising copy. Quote, "Every race man and woman should cast aside their skepticism regarding the Negro's ability as a motion picture star and go and see The Homesteader, not only for the absorbing interest obtaining herein, but as an appreciation of those finer arts which no race can ignore and hope to obtain a higher plane of thought and action." Enthusiasm started rising, particularly in local black communities, for Oscar Micheaux's movie. The first premiere showing was planned to take place at the 8,000 seat Regiment Armory, a Chicago facility that catered to blacks. Oscar Micheaux wanted to make the evening extra special, so he invited members of a local regiment of black soldiers, known as the Illinois Black Devils, who had seen action in World War I. A short documentary had been made about their exploits, and Micheaux arranged to have it shown preceding the showing of his film. This was like the first filmmaker in this nation who was black who got his movies into theaters. This next section hops ahead. In the 70s, there was no black man or woman running a film studio. And then Berry Gordy from Motown thought he would come up with an idea to make films. He already had somebody who he thought he could turn into a star, and that was Diana Ross. So this is a moment in the book when Diana Ross's movie fame has started to rise. They began screaming her name, "Diana! Diana!" She turned, and then the cameras would flash, truly capturing her movie star smile. Her shoulders were broad, her waist was so thin, and she looked dazzling in her clothes, as stylish as any black fashion model on any runway. She was becoming a pop princess and a pop icon all at once. "Diana! Diana!" They performed on the soundtrack for The Happening, a goofy 1967 counterculture movie that starred George Maharis, Michael Parks, Milton Berle, and Faye Dunaway, kids and guns and mistaken identities and hijinks. Their song, The Happening, was yet another number one hit. There were growing rumors that Diana Ross might leave the group. To keep her in the fold, Berry Gordy realized that concessions would have to be made. So, another name change, Diana Ross and the Supremes.
Like most everyone, Berry Gordy loved the movies, but complained that Hollywood didn't understand the breadth and scope of black stories, of black storytelling. The black exploitation movies to him were mere romps geared toward black audiences with hopes that whites might become intrigued and add to the box office. His Motown was different. Whites had waltzed into its web effortlessly and intended to stay. He had turned the label into a crossover juggernaut. Singers from his label, Michael Jackson, The Supremes, had already sung on white movie soundtracks, and their theme songs had become hits. Berry Gordy, reclining in his Motown office chair, started thinking of Hollywood, a place where not a single black executive had the power to greenlight a movie. None of that mattered to him. He made up his mind he was going to get into the damn movie business. He wanted to make movies with Diana Ross, because Ross was more than just the supremely talented lead singer of the Supremes. She had become Berry Gordy's lover. As the hit went, "Love is like an itching in my heart." This next section, brings us sort of up to what's going on now in the world that we all live in. And I talk about Spike Lee in a few of his unknown movies. In June 2020, the ever-busy Spike Lee entered the fray. He released a short film, Three Brothers, Radio Raheem, Eric Garner, and George Floyd. It bracketed newsreel footage from the murders of George Floyd and Eric Garner with the fictional murder of Radio Raheem from Lee's Do the Right Thing. It's an eerie film, as if Lee, in his 1989 movie, had been able to see the dark side of the American future, that the police chokehold would come to be as racially catastrophic as the lynch rope. Not long after Floyd's murder, on June 12th, a white Atlanta cop shot Rayshard Brooks, a black man, in the back, killing him. It too was captured on video. That cop was arrested and charged with murder. Four officers were finally arrested and charged with the murder of George Floyd. The names of other blacks killed in recent years at the hands of law enforcement resurface: Eric Garner, Trayvon Martin, Tamir Rice. Quote, "I call the young people who grew up in the past 25 years the Trayvon generation," Elizabeth Alexander would write in the New Yorker magazine soon after the Floyd murder. Quote, "They always knew these stories. These stories formed their worldview. These stories helped instruct young African Americans about their embodiment and their vulnerability. The stories were primers in fear and futility. The stories were the ground soil of their rage." End quote. She went on, quote, "They watched these violations up close and on their cell phones so many times over. They watched them in near real time. They watch them on the school bus. They watch them under the covers at night, end quote. And here's the last little snippet. They kept marching. They marched down Highland Avenue in Hollywood, old and young, in black and white, in Hispanic and Asian, all in the aftermath of the George Floyd murder. The Hollywood marchers turned attention to Hollywood itself. Black actors and actresses became part of an initiative, Hollywood for Black Lives, and wrote a letter to the industry, quote, "Hollywood has a privilege as a creative industry to imagine and create. We have significant influence over culture and politics. We have the ability to use our influence to imagine and create a better world. Yet, historically and currently, Hollywood encourages the epidemic of police violence and culture of anti-blackness. The way the Hollywood and mainstream media have contributed to the criminalization of black people, the misrepresentation of the legal system, and the glorification of police corruption and violence have had dire consequences on black lives," end quote. In November 2020, a president and vice president who refused to utter the word Black Lives Matter before the public were voted out of office. President Joseph Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris, the first woman of color to hold the vice presidency, took office on January 20, 2021. Thank you.
Will Haygood. Let's give a big Columbus round of applause for Will Haygood. All right, we've got plenty of time for audience Q&A, and I know many of you have come to see Will, so raise your hand if you have a question about one of his prior books, about colorization, about one of the films that he talked about in colorization, and we have a couple folks out here with microphones. Raise them up, don't be shy. All right, well, right here.
Hi, and I just wanted to thank you. This is just so good to be out, so good to hear someone of your caliber to come to Columbus and share your experiences with us. My question is, it seems to me that there's a growing movement to include more people of color in movies recently, and I say since the George Floyd situation. I've seen it on television, and I've seen mixed couples more so than I've ever seen it before. So my question to you is this a moment in time, or is this going to be a movement to continue on like this?
Yes, I personally think that Hollywood has definitely gotten the memo, no doubt about it. Oscar So White was a big movement in this country, and it put Hollywood on the front page of newspapers. And there are filmmakers now. Streaming services have opened their arms wide, and they want good stories, good storytelling. Here's a good example. Roots, the big book by Alex Haley. He sold it to the movies first. He wanted it to be a big 3-hour film. And but Hollywood, the studio that had it, got real nervous. You know, that's a lot of black people on the screen at the same time. We need to think about this. And so Haley, he took money out of his own pocket and he bought back the rights to his book and took it to TV, to the small screen. I'm really happy that he did, because it became a sensation. The whole country sat in front of their TVs, what was that, 1976, and watched Roots. And it was the first time, too, that whites in this country, many, many whites in this country, was the first time that they talked to their families about slavery and about racism. Roots was the first time, the medium. It is a powerful medium, TV and film. I wrote a book, King of the Cats, about the great New York congressman, Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Only this year has Hollywood started to call me to ask me about that book. I mean, it would make a great movie, Hazel Scott and Powell and his world and all those Southern Democrats that he had to battle with. But it took the George Floyd murder to wake people up.
All right, over on your far left, Will. Oh, sorry.
No.
In the course of researching and writing the book, did you have any, like, obviously you know literature and entertainment and things like that, any what could have been moments, like, did you learn something you said, oh, wow, I wonder if that had actually come to pass, or were there any personalities that you got a totally new perspective on in the course of your research and writing?
You know, let me think about that. One of the things that, you know, was very sad to me in reading about in the actresses and the actors in the 1930s, 1940s, 1950s, and on, is that so many of them died young. So many of them died in their 30s and 40s and 50s, fairly young. And I would write about somebody, and then I would have to bury them, you know, and I would have to have their funeral, sort of, in the book, because I wanted the reader to know what happened. And some days it would make me so sad that I would have to go for a walk, because I wanted some of those folks from the 40s and the 50s, I wish that they could have held on to 1964, to the Civil Rights Act, because these were people who had to go around the country on stages or acting. And they had to worry before they got to that town to film their part in the movie or to do their scenes, you know. They had to worry if they could find a place to sleep that night. They had to worry if they could go into a restaurant without someone calling them the N-word. It's hard enough to be an actor or actress. Any white actor or actress can tell you that, and will tell you that. But to have that dual challenge, okay, I'm here in town, I filmed my scenes, I'm 300 miles from where I live, so I can't drive back home tonight, so now I gotta start looking around this town to see if I can find a place to stay. That's just very painful. And you know, that part of the story, I never found that in books. And so I really wanted to tell that story, how hard it was just to survive in America as an entertainer.
Got one right up here in the front. Raise your hands, we'll get another one queued up.
Hello, thank you for coming, and I'm from Chillicothe, Ohio, and you have really inspired me so much to where I watched The Butler last night, and then I wake up this morning to the news saying you're gonna be here. I run a facility in Chillicothe that helps women and young children, so I'm in the community a lot, and I hear a lot of stories. So my question to you is, how can I get you to Chillicothe, Ohio?
I can't get me to Chillicothe.
Because I hear a lot of stories, there's a lot of talent. How can I get you there so the children can actually see,
yes,
you know, if they write this down, that they can also become Will Haygood?
Yes, yes, yes. Well, thank you. If you see the lady right here with the microphone, she will pass on my contact, and I can tell the people up in New York who represent me that you're interested in having me come to Chillicothe, and we'll work it out. We'll work it out.
Hi, Will. Thank you so much for being here. It was a real pleasure. Mike, I do have a copy of the book, and I intend to read all of it, but I jumped 2 days ago. I decided to jump to the chapter, I think it was chapter 3, on the Imitation Game, about the movie The Imitation of Life,
mm-hmm.
a movie which I saw as a very young boy and which had quite an impact on me. So my question is, the interesting thing about it was a financial success. I didn't realize how much of a financial success it was, that you mentioned in your book. And the other one of the other nice tidbits there was that it was directed by a German-born person who married a Jewish woman.
Right.
And that was evidently the only movie he directed in the United States because of for a variety of reasons, I guess. But my question is, what did Hollywood? This was 1959. What did Hollywood learn from that, and what did Hollywood not learn from that? In terms of, especially given the success of that and the time that it was made.
Yeah. The star of that movie, Juanita Moore, she played a maid. And so you ask me what Hollywood learned from that? Her phone didn't ring for 4 years. Took her 4 years, 3 to 4 years to get her next role. And her next role was as a maid. And so even though it was a success, that movie, and it was really the first big screen movie and that really talked about racial pain inside of a family that's black. For those of you who don't know the film, it's about a woman who works for a white family, and as their maid, and her daughter is very light of skin, and her daughter goes around town, and she tells other people that she's white. Very painful, heart-wrenching movie to watch because somebody asked the daughter in the movie about Jesus, and she says, "Jesus is white, just like me." And there's one scene where the mother goes to the school with the daughter. Now the mother's skin is, you know, she's dark skin, noticeably black. And she knocks on the door of this classroom. And she knows that her daughter is in that classroom with all of the other white kids. And she opens the door and the school teacher says, "May I help you?" And she says, "Yes, I'm here to see my daughter." And she kind of vaguely points, and her daughter kind of slinks under the desk, hiding from the mother. And it's just heartbreakingly, heartbreakingly painful, that scene. But Hollywood might have had a moment then to do something, and they didn't, for whatever reason. They didn't.
Okay, right here.
Hi. I'm a Panther from Lyndon McKinley, so I know the Tigers were.
Oh my, Tigers and Panthers, oh my.
Yes, that was from your era. So anyway, I'm asking about Tyler Perry Studios and what comments do you have about his independence going from Hollywood?
Yeah, wonderful for him, you know. He'll probably be a little upset with me because there's not a whole lot about Tyler Perry here in this book. But he has talent. He knows how to, you know, he knows how to work within the system. Even with 100 years, I certainly couldn't write about all filmmakers. So there's just not a lot in the book about him. There's something here in the book about him, of course. Yeah, but.
Will, The Birth of a Nation, should it be taught in film school today? And if so, what can we learn from it? And if not, why not?
In The Birth of a Nation, should it be taught in film schools? Yes, you know, I mean, it should be looked at and viewed. Yeah. It's a very racist film, a brutish film, but yes, it should be looked at in the aura, in the orbit of reading this book, because it is a great moment for film students to see how cinema was weaponized against blacks. That's a great thing to know and to watch and to view. There's a line in the book. Has anybody got the book handy, the hardback book? Can they bring it? Anybody got it? Here you go. Leave it up to my sister. She's got the book. She's ready to come up here and give you a review. Here's something that I didn't have a chance to read, but here. In the summer of 1919, 4 years after The Birth of a Nation had its official opening, a wave of race riots swept the nation. The episodes were beyond horrendous. On so many fronts, black Americans were beaten down politically and legally. And cinema had now achieved a new place in society with a nation-shaking film that blacks found abhorrent. The Birth of a Nation was big business in America. Men got rich. Careers were indelibly made. The film even helped change the dynamics of how America went to the movies. Theater owners began keeping theaters open with longer hours. They started realizing more than ever the sheer profitability of snacks at their concession stands and added even more goodies. But all of this had been done at a terrible price to Black America. It seemed as if Blacks had yet one more enemy, cinema. There are heroic stories in this book about white men, white women, women like Barbara Stanwyck, men like Ralph Nelson and Stanley Kramer, who went out of their way to hire Blacks, who fought with the studios to put Blacks in their films, Sidney Poitier and others. And those stories are heartbreaking too, because these white men and white women sacrificed something. They went to bat for Black talent. And it's really wonderful to know those stories as well.
Okay, right here.
Hi, Mr. Haygood.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Maddie Grooms from Monroe.
Yep. Maddie, how you doing?
I'm good. I have a question about your writing methodology. How earlier you said something to the effect of your conversation and your interaction with children, but considering that, you know, TikTok and social media are, you know, the big things today, what's your methodology for writing your book? Because you have such a way with words, and you actually make the people that you are writing about, they come alive at the moment that, you know, you're reading about, you know, or reading those words on, you know, those pages. So what's your, you know, do you create a special ambiance? Do you write it out first and someone else types it, or what's your process?
Well, thank you very much for saying what you said about in my writing. I really do spend a lot of time on the words in the writing. I need absolute quiet to write, absolute quiet. And I'll close my door in my writing study and just write. I mean, I spent 4 years on this book, and the first 2 years before the health crisis hit, and I was able to fly around the country and meet people. You know, I went to Atlanta to see the actor, Louis Gossett Jr., who's an Academy Award winner. He was so helpful, so full of information. And I was tired. It had been a long day, and I landed. And I hopped in a taxi to go to his house. He lived about 50 miles outside of Atlanta. And I got into his house, and, you know, I was tired. And I said that to him. He said, how about a swim? I'm a swim, you know, it's nippy outside. He told me to walk around the corner to his living room, and I did, and there was a swimming pool in Louis Gossett's house in Atlanta. You know, hooray for Hollywood. So I ran upstairs. He gave me some swimming trunks. That's the first time I've ever swam inside of someone's house. But, and that's just one of the many, many, many stories from working on this book and meeting people and talking to people. So many actresses and actors, so many of them asked me when I started this book, said, how will you do this book? And I mean, like, there's so much stuff
together to write? How will you do it? And I just said, and I'll do what I've always done. What James Baldwin told me when I met him as a young reporter, he told me, he said, whatever you do in life, you must go the way your blood beats. And that's what I've done. And I figured if I told myself that the mountain was too high to climb, then I would never get up there. So I just went at it, week by week by week.
Mr. Haygood, you and Michael Schultz the other night talked about images in film, both positive and negative images, and trying to get father figures put into television films about black families. And in the early 90s, we had an event here in Columbus where we had Blair Underwood and Kim Fields and Robert Hooks and Barbara Oh talk about positive images in films. Where do you see it going now? Because you see so much negativity where you don't have the father figure, or you see guns and violence. And when you think about internalized oppression or racial hegemony in films, where do you see this going? Because it seems like we're going backwards again to where, you know, the people that were fighting back in the, you know, 70s and 80s around positive images, we are losing ground. What are your thoughts?
Yes. There is so much talent out there now, young filmmakers, hungry filmmakers. I see from this point on and that the cinema world is definitely going to get richer. I think things will definitely get much better, much broader. I really think the past 2-3 years have really been, you know, a moment that the people who run Hollywood have had to wake up. There was a study, and it's mentioned in the book, there was a study by some Wall Street firm that it said Hollywood in the year 2020, maybe the study was done from like 2018 to 2020, said that by refusing to make diverse movies that blacks would want to see, Hollywood has left $250 billion plus dollars on the table. And they always talk about, we don't care about black or white, all we care about is green. Well, you leaving a whole lot of it on the table, how do you justify that? I don't think that they are going to be able to justify that anymore. I mean, The Butler, story I wrote and got turned into the film, as you all know. No studio wanted to finance it. So Lee Daniels and Sheila Johnson and Laura Ziskin went around and raised the money from 40 to 45 people. They asked them each, you know, $30,000 over here, $50,000 over there, and they raised the money. And the movie opened, thanks to you all. Thank you very much. The movie opened number one at the box office.
All right.
And then the second week at the box office, it was still number one. The third week at the box office, it was still number one. Oh, you should have seen me in Washington, D.C. I had my groove on that week. 3 straight weeks, the number one movie. For the first 10 weeks, it stayed in the top 10. There was an article that came out in some magazine. This was 2013, some magazine. This article said, Hollywood finally gets emancipated. In 2013, he watched a movie in 1959 and asked me, what changed? Well, in 2013, we had that headline, finally
gets emancipated. And there are people, though, right now in Hollywood who know that things have to get better. And I have no doubt that things will get better. But we have to go see the movies that we want to see. You know, we have to support those filmmakers. You know, we really have to do that. So there's a lot of things happening for the better. But it's a struggle. You know, it takes, you know, it's a struggle. I had an actor call me and tell me that, a well-known actor call me and tell me that he thinks that this book is going to empower every black actor, actress, cinematographer, filmmaker in Hollywood. So my fingers are crossed. I hope it does.
All right, we're almost at time here. We're gonna take two more questions, this gentleman, and then someone in the back, and then we'll wrap up and we'll have time to sign books.
Will, Leonard King here. First of all, I wanna say I love you. I'm not gay, but you know where we come from, and you never, you know, see, everyone thinks that, you know, we just really weren't supposed to be here. But I need for you to expound on our little drama class at Ohio Dominican and how it set the path, you know, for we both just really got started. And then I'd like for you to expound on the part in the book about our first black female Academy Award winner and what happened to her.
Okay, yep, yep. And that's Leonard King, dear friend of mine. We were in Upward Bound together, and so we read books together, and we talked about movies and sports, and we played basketball together, and he went on to college, and he not only got a BA degree, he got a master's degree. He always holds that over me. All I have is a BA degree. Yes, there was a drama program when I was in Upward Bound. It's so funny, too, this morning or this afternoon, when I got here, I parked right behind the library, and there used to be in this city the Players Theater. It was a local theatrical troupe. And I auditioned for a role in that stage play. And I got a part sitting up in the segregated balcony. You know, and I put everything I had into that little nameless role, though. You know, I showed up on time every day, you know, thinking, oh boy, I'm getting ready to go to Hollywood. I might be the next Sidney Harry Belafonte. I'm ready to strike out for Hollywood from this little role. And I'ma use it, I'ma work this little role. I mean, you know, I had a 1940s pair of jeans that, you know, at the prop department gave me. I had an old raggedy torn shirt, you know. I think I was listed in the program third guy from left. I think that's what it said, third guy from left. I was up in the balcony, I was like up there. But it wasn't for me, Leonard. You know, I just didn't have that kind of drive. But this is interesting. Listen to this. A famous actor, now famous, he was fairly famous then. He was in The Butler. Well, heck, I'll give you his name. David Oyelowo, great actor. He comes up to me one day and he says, "Will, since you wrote the story, you need to go to the director, Lee Daniels, and tell him that you want a little scene, like walking across the street, or maybe sitting someplace in the park as Forrest Whitaker is walking by." And I said, "Gee, David, I don't know, man, seriously?" He said, "Man, you need to go. Hey, look, man, my kid is in a little cotton plantation scene." So I was able to get my kid a little scene. So go over to Lee's trailer and knock on the door and tell Lee that you want a little teeny moment extra, way in the background or something. And I said, "Hey, man, you doggone right, David. I'm going to do it." Yeah, you know, y'all wouldn't be here if it wasn't for me. I found the butler. God, that, David, give me some, man. You're right. So as I'm walking to Lee's trailer, his window is open on the trailer, and he's in there screaming. He's on the telephone. "I told you I'm $50,000 short to finish this damn movie. I need that $50,000 wired to me within the next 2 hours. And then he turns around and he sees me standing in the doorway and he says, "What, Will?" Whoa. Whoa. And I said, "Hey, Lee, man, I just wanted to say hello. You know, man, I'm just going to get something to eat over there at the truck." Whoa, I got out of there quick. Oh. But Lee later called me and said, "Will, I own the rights to your Sammy Davis Jr. book, and when I make that movie, you're going to be in it." Whoa.
All right, we've got time for one more right here back in the back in the yellow shirt.
Yes, I am so proud to be a Tiger, and I would like to tip my hat to our coach, Pinnell, and my friend in the back, Eddie Radliff. I'm Wanda Suber, and I graduated from East High School during that time. I want to say to you, we are so proud of you, and you are carrying out the purpose that the Lord has given you, and you're doing a great job at it. Let me say
Thank you.
Of all of the work that you've done, you know, a lot of times when we're in our homes, we think, you know, I would like for people to remember me for this. And Maya Angelou said, people may not remember what you said, they may not remember what you do, but they will always remember how you made them feel. You made me feel so proud today. So everything that's embedded in your books, what would you like to leave with all of us and to leave us with a feeling that we will always remember Will Haygood?
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. You know, there are moments in your life, I think, that mean so much to you if you're a writer or an artist. You know, and I think one feature of what I've tried to do is tell stories that were not told before, stories that were ignored or lost. That butler who I found, he died 15 months after I knocked on his door. And his story would have been gone, lost. And so I realize to this day, I think how lucky I am. I mean, to have people who care about the words that I write, to have Vonzell Johnson as a dear friend of mine. I mean, that means the world to me. I mean, he saw something in me when I was a kid and moved to the housing projects. And I mean, he stood up for me. He wouldn't let anybody bully me, you know? I mean, it's all I had to say. If somebody got smart with me, man, I can't wait to run into Vonzell because I know he's gonna wanna know about how you treated me. Stop right there. Boom, shut it down. You know, and then my sister, Diane, giving me money to go to the YWCA. I mean, yeah, YWCA, she worked there. Not the YMCA, the YWCA. So I could learn how to swim. You know, just these little things that you think about and you look back on in life. All these little moments add up, all these little moments. I wanted to run away when I got to New York City. And after college, I was nervous, I was scared, you know, it was noisy, I wasn't used to it. And I was gonna come home, I was gonna come back home, and my sister told me to tough it out. Tough it out. Stay there and tough it out. So I did. I wanna thank the musicians. This has made my day. Every city that I go into, and I'ma tell them that you're lagging because where's your musicians? Where's the music? Oh, I mean, that was just so beautiful. Maddie, sometimes after writing, I would listen to a soundtrack from the music, not during the writing, but sometimes after writing. You know, I would listen to soundtrack music. But to hear that music live, this is the first time I've heard it live. It's, I don't know, it's made the book really come alive in a whole new way for me. It really has. So I thank you very much for that.
Are we good?
I think that's it. I'm going to sign some books and I'm going to chat.
Let's give it up again for Will Haygood. And let's hear it for the Urban Jazz Coalition. Let's get the musicians back up on stage to play us out. Will's books will be available for sale over at the Friends of the Library table, and he will be back at the Orange Wall signing those books. Thank you all for coming today. Have a great afternoon.
Craig McMullen. They asked us to play some more Superfly music.
Yeah, we used to work at night.
All right. What an honor to have been a part of this as you folks purchase and have your CD, not CDs, books signed. We'll play some more music featuring Mr. Craig A. Marlin. Check.
Y'all ready?
Yeah.
Count it. Hey.
Yeah, Wood.
Craig.
Doc McDaniels, I'm going to call you. No problem. You got it. Bernice, don't tell him to spend it on nothing frivolous. Frivolous. That's a word I learned up there with him. Frivolous. Thank you.
check. You got me, Paul. Creamy Marlin, Superfly, Creamy Marlin. As you know, that was from the movie, and the title of that was Pusher Man, which is really more of a look at reality at that particular time, and maybe with all the other things that are going on today, you can also say that there's a different name used for some of the things, but still there's somewhat of a pusher man out there. Whether or not he has a DR in front of his name, it's not necessarily that he's doing it on purpose, but sometimes we, as people, have a tendency to take advantage to make it a disadvantage. But basically that song, without using the words, describes things that were happening at that time and also today. The next song we're gonna do, and we cannot forget this movie. This is the first one. This is a movie that inspired me, that when I had a chance to play the soundtrack for Superfly, preceding me was Isaac Hayes doing Shaft. And the guitar player that he had doing the wah-wah stuff was Skip Pitts. And so therefore, I'm in, have the pleasure of being here with the Urban Jazz Coalition. The next song that you will hear before you have to pay to get out of here. Oh, they didn't tell y'all that. Oh, y'all thought y'all was in here for free? Oh, no, no, we don't roll like that. Thank y'all for laughing, because they about ready to put me out of the band, too.
Yeah.
We get ready to do Shaft. I got it from the man, say, yeah, you're right about that. No, we get ready, and all the high school, we get ready to do the Academy Award-winning theme from the movie Shaft, entitled, so I won't get the Shaft, Shaft, okay?
Here we go.
somebody for Mr. Craig McMullen, y'all. Superfly, Craig McMullen. All right, all right.
Thank you very much, thank you very much. Again, I've had the pleasure of being with my brothers here, the Columbus's own Urban Jazz Coalition.
Thank y'all so much. My brother Craig. All right, as folks continue to purchase this literary masterpiece and get their book signed, we're going to play some music from our repertoire for you. We're going to kick it off doing one featuring Mr. Brandon Howard. It's entitled, I don't know, let me look at the list. Horizon. Thank you. Mr. Brandon, how was y'all? All right, we're gonna take you back a little bit. This song was recently, well, I won't say recently, but most recently done by an artist that we love, Mr. Kirk Whalum. But y'all might remember Tevin Campbell. Anybody here remember Tevin? Yeah. You do? Well, we got one. So we're gonna do this one for you. Thank you. Mr. Randolph, y'all. Thanks again so much to Mr. Craig McMullen for coming out with us today and schooling us on the Superfly era. Help us get it right. I'll have your money tomorrow. I'll call you, man. As soon as Javon give me the check, we good. Thanks so much to Mr. Javon Collins and the King Arts Complex and great folks here at the Columbus Metropolitan Public Library for having us. And so much to Mr. Will Haygood for asking us to be a part of this. Thank you. Thank you so much. We're going to keep the music going. We're going to feature our guitarist, Mr. Dwayne Tribune, on a song by an artist that we love. We haven't played enough of his music over the years, Mr. Ray Oviedo. This one's entitled Coco. You know what? Before we get started, I will be remiss if I didn't have you put your hands together for our tremendous sound man, Mr. Paul Lofton, back there. We couldn't do this without Paul. King Arts Complex, your Heritage Festival. If you need a man, that's your man right there. All right. Yeah. He got theme music and everything. All right, let's do this. Thank you. Dwayne DeBute on guitar. On the flute, Mr. Richard Randall. How about a boy drummer back here, Mr. Rico Adams? On percussion, Hector Maldonado. On the keyboards, Mr. Brandon Howard. And the next voice you will hear, Mr. Doug Neal, trombone, guitar, and vocals.
There it is. How are we all doing today? All right. Well, you know what they say about Columbus, Ohio, if you don't like the weather, wait an hour. It's our pleasure, it's our honor to be here. Thank you to the Columbus Library. Thank you to Mr. Will Haygood, and congratulations again on another amazing publication, amazing book. I look forward to getting my copy and sinking my teeth into it, as well should all of you, if you haven't already. This is the part You've enjoyed this wonderful, brilliant speech. Q&A, what a beautiful day. In spite of Columbus still not making up, is it fall, is it spring? We don't know yet, but we'll figure out soon enough. Ooh, this is the audience participation point of the afternoon. So if I can, I need a little bit of help today. Just a little bit, ooh, just a little bit of help today. It's real simple, just like this. It's a lovely, so, so lovely. It's a lovely. There's not even going to be a quiz there. It's that easy. It's a lovely, so, so lovely. It's a lovely. One more time for Mr. Haygood. It's a lovely, so, so lovely. It's a lovely. Feel it now. It's a lovely. So, so lovely. It's a lovely.
Slow it down for just a minute. I would like to say, though, hello to Mr. Timmy Hout, Heatwave's former drummer right here. You know, Columbus got some talent. We got people that play with Curtis Mayfield, Aretha Franklin, Heatwave, a little bit of everybody. And so give this man a round of applause. A lifetime of great music. All righty, all right. Let's feature Mr. Richard Randolph on some Gerald Albright.